Welcome to this special discussion where we're going to talk about ad fraud, something which concerns all of us, especially in the digital space. If you look closely, ad fraud has been a persistent problem for many years now. And over the last 5 months, especially when there has been a big digital leap, ad fraud has become a concern that needs to be sorted on priority. And the fact that there are loss of billions of dollars every year to advertisers, to brands, because of ad fraud online, there is a need to build a movement to address this issue. And that's exactly what we're doing here at Exchange for Media. So Exchange for Media, in partnership with MFilterIt, has decided to take on this ad fraud in a very big way. So this is the first one of the a series of attempts that we are making, and today we are discussing what are the ways, what are the most effective ways to address this problem. And with us today we have an esteemed panel of experts. Let me introduce them. We have with us Mr. Pavrush Elavia, who is the head digital marketing and growth Z5. He also manages the entire digital marketing piece for Z5. Welcome, Mr. Elavia. We have Mr. Arvind RP, Director of Marketing and Communications, McDonald's India. He has a rich experience of 20 years of sales and marketing and understands this bit very well. And welcome, Mr. Arvind, to this discussion. We have Mr. Ankit Banga. He's the head of marketing, India Bulls Housing and Dhani. Let me tell you that he has been instrumental in the digital transformation of selling traditional financial products. And he has been the person who has made Dhani the growth story. You know, everyone knows about it. He's the man responsible for it. Welcome, Mr. Banga. We also have Mr. Gaurav Shitak. He's the vice president and head digital marketing Share Khan. Gaurav comes with a rich experience in diverse sectors such as retail, e-commerce, cement, hospitality. So he's going to share his diverse viewpoints with us today. And finally, we also have Mr. Prabhakar Tiwari, CMO, Angel Broking Limited. Mr. Tiwari spearheads brand performance marketing and PR initiatives for the firm. As we know, the firm has seen rapid improvements in its digital maturity metrics and market share gains under his leadership. Welcome, Mr. Tiwari. And last and not the least is Mr. Dheeraj Gupta, CTO and co-founder MFilterIt. He would be moderating this special panel on ad fraud. So I hand it over to Mr. Gupta from here. Over to you.
Thank you so much, Rohel, for the kind introduction. And to all my panelists and to the attendees, welcome to this session. We're going to keep this very, very engaging, and I hope to get the key insights out from this esteemed panel. We have with us we have an interesting panel because we have three participants from the fintech space. We have a representation from the OTT space and from snacking and food delivery. And I think in these interesting times of COVID, I think these are industries, OTT, fintech, and maybe a little bit of education we could have added in, what is, you know, where most of the focus and attention has been on. And deliveries and, online presence has become very, very important in this period. Just giving a sense, Maruti came out with a very interesting fact recently saying that about 50% of their test drives actually got booked digitally. I mean, never ever is an automotive giant, which has always been using dealerships, distributors for its, offline inventory, is coming and saying 50% of my test drives got booked digitally. That's I think, a massive shift which something like COVID has done. We have, you know, brands like LG and Sony opening up e-stores, Marks & Spencer opening its e-store in India in the last couple of months. So direct-to-consumer has become a big thing. Now, obviously, when this happens, unfortunately, it also brings with it a bubble. And in a lot of cases, bubbles end up converting into fraud. So a recent study we did for a lot of our clients saw that attempts for ad fraud actually increased in the last 3 months. More and more focus has been on digital, which means there are more dollars to steal, and hence, the in terms of absolute value, there is a higher trend in fraud in the last couple of months, which I think is important for all of us to be aware about. Some interesting and the other part which I wanted to also do a quick introduction on is I don't know if you tracked the recent rally by President Trump, right? Very very different topic. President Trump, started a rally in Tulsa, and they opened up a registration page which had a phone number registration, and 1 million Republicans signed up for that, right? 1 million new people signed up for attending that rally. Mr. Trump was very, very excited, and, 1 million people are going to attend his rally. When he landed, that rally was attended by 6,000 people, and it was found that all those registrations which were coming on the lead page were actually bots, right? So I think if the president of the United States can get impacted by something like this, then I think we are mere mortals. I think all of us need to be conscious and, with humility accept that bots are, present everywhere. It's important that we protect our campaigns against it. So let me carry forward the discussion basis this introduction. So what I will do is I will, run through each of the panelists, and what I want to understand first for the audience is, what kind of campaigns are you running in your organization? When you're running those campaigns, what is how are you measuring them? What is the measuring platform you're using? And what are the metrics you're using to identify whether, are you meeting the key ROI metrics on it or not, right? So just let's, try and get the baseline set in so that all of us know exactly what kind of campaign is running and how you're measuring it. So let's start. Ankit, over to you. Maybe you want to start first as to what you're running, how you're measuring, and what are the key things you're looking out for right now on your campaign.
So thank you, Dheeraj, and hi, everyone. So basically, we run Dhani app campaigns, which are largely app-focused campaigns, and there are multiple products now on Dhani, and therefore there are different objectives of each campaign that we run. And not necessarily that, we don't run on common objectives because there is a different business goal or a different goal that we're trying to achieve with each campaign that we run. So primarily our campaigns are top focused to registrations, and we have now evolved from, running install campaigns to at least minimum, if you have to run a top of the funnel campaign, we would prefer running a registration focused campaigns. And then obviously we have deeper funnel event campaigns that we run, but the ROI definitely, by the end of the day, we measure basis orders and acquisitions or disbursals or sanctions or et cetera. So which are slightly more deeper, but that's the internal evaluation that we do for each campaign. However, when we're running on platforms, on digital platforms, we use either of these two events to start campaigns, to run campaigns. Coming to what platforms are we using, we looking at the scale that we would want to achieve, we try and use all platforms possibly, all the biddable media and the affiliate side of media. However, we obviously focus largely on the biddable media to start with, and then supplement the whole campaigns with affiliates, etc. So that's about it. Yeah.
Okay. Parush, over to you, Z5.
Hey, thanks, Dheeraj. Yeah. For us as well, we're an OTT app, right? So we use a lot of user acquisition campaigns to begin with. That's the first thing that we start off with, getting the users on board, ensuring that they are starting and engaging with our app. After that, we use down the funnel campaigns, which basically convert users from viewing videos to actually going ahead and then subscribing to our platform as well. We run campaigns, me and my team run campaigns across the globe, right? So Z5 now is an app which is available all the way from Canada to UK to Middle East, Bangladesh, Pakistan, everywhere, right? So we basically run campaigns on multiple platforms, multiple types of campaigns we have to do. We go through biddable media, we go through programmatic, we go through networks, affiliates, and web as well as app is where we see all of our campaign structure being kind of meshed up. Yeah.
Understood. Arvind from McDonald's side.
Yeah, so over the years, our focus has shifted significantly towards digital, away from traditional media. And on digital, we do a fair bit of both branding and performance campaign through the year. A performance campaign for McDelivery, which is for food delivery, largely is app focused on our app McDelivery, with a small chunk of website focus. And again, in terms of platforms, we do focus on biddable, programmatic, fair bit of affiliates, and hence a significant issue of ad frauds to tackle. So broadly, that's the kind of span that we have through the year.
Understood. Gaurav, and then Mr. Prabhakar, if you could shed some light on that. Gaurav.
Okay, so probably from our side, we do all the campaigns. We are like very heavy on digital. I think digital is the primarily medium for us. Others are always secondary medium. So probably we are doing all sort of campaigns, right? Be it on social media, be it app, be it affiliate marketing, biddable, programmatic, and so on and so forth. And primarily, if you really ask me from an ROI perspective or what are the metrics, it depends. It depends on the objective, because I normally see that we are kind of a support to a business. So maybe a business team has a different goal or objective to achieve. So probably a campaign has to be made that way. Probably sometime it is hardcore performance, which where the maximum of your time and budget goes, because that's what drives the organization. But definitely sometime businesses also have an objective to reach out to certain set of customers and so on and so forth. I think objectives vary from campaign to campaign. But ultimately, if you ask me, the gold standard is after doing all attribution, first click, last click, whatever you want to do, you are putting this much of money. How much money you were able to generate, and what was the velocity of the money? How fast, quickly you were able to recover that money? That could be maybe for a hardcore performance campaign, that could be. But yes, definitely there are other campaigns which we also run. Each campaign has their own set of objectives.
So effectively, return on ad spends is, I think, what you are optimizing against and making sure that you're getting more in terms of the returns from the investment you're putting in.
Obviously, that has to, that is the major part of anybody who is maybe leading marketing. Probably if you have put in so much of money, what is coming out? Maybe whether you build a brand or you do a performance campaign, you do whatever, but over a period of time, that money has to start coming back to the organization.
No, I think before we just come to Mr. Tiwari, I think kudos to all of you, because we keep coming across a lot of advertisers who are still focused on vanity metrics, who are still focused on impression campaigns. I think all of you, by arriving and dealing with performance issues and getting focusing on ROS, which is the end metric, which you can always make sure you are actually getting value for the organization. So thank you for that, Mr. Tiwari, from your side, yeah.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks, Action for Media and Amfiltrate for this panel discussion. I'm glad to be here. And talking about Angel Broking, like we are a digital broker, 2.5 decades old. So we have seen a lot of digital transformation. And we believe in full funnel marketing. And the full funnel marketing means that the brand team and the performance marketing team has to work very closely. And definitely digital is the kind of main medium for us there. So in case of performance marketing, of course, like we use biddable, we have programmatic, we have DV360, we have network affiliates, so multiple kind of marketing efforts. And there our focus is more both in paid and organic. In paid, we have DV360, GA360, and Google Campaign Manager. So it's a full stack which is there. And we also run a lot of AIML programs also, just to kind of make our campaigns more efficient. Now talking about the metrics, of course, basically we look at CO and CPL, like everything kind of boils down to that in performance marketing. And in brand marketing also, we have moved from a TV led model to more YouTube and OTT led model. So we have experimented a lot with Hotstar, earlier TikTok, now Roposo, Chingari, MX Player, Jio TV, multiple platform we check out. And apart from looking at CPV and cost per install, we also look at CPL and COA of brand campaign also. We allow it to be slightly higher, so that's fine. But we have also seen that, sometimes they're very competitive. And coming to ad fraud scenario, there could be multiple. However, thankfully, programmatic give us a lot of control. In Apps Flyer, we're able to look at, you know, a lot of these control feature which are there. So overall, you know, we are very very clear that, you know, I mean, we have to be more efficient. We have to be more efficient as a marketer. So ad fraud is a big concern, and we look at new age tools to solve it.
Yeah, by the way, when you were mentioning all the OTTs, Porush was smiling and he was wondering, you know, I'm sure he's going to reach out to you after this. Hey, get D5 on. But thank you so much. So let's just quickly jump in on the whole ad fraud thing. So Ankit, you've been you know, on this whole Dhani app. Dhani app has a lot of fintech focus, and obviously there's a lot of, there's more to lose than just marketing dollars, right? I mean, potentially you're probably losing on financials and so on, which is a more heavily regulated sector. So from that viewpoint, any interesting fraud examples you saw and you encountered, which might be very interesting for the audience? Some examples on your marketing in the last, say, 1.5 years?
So, Dheeraj, I think fraud is part and parcel of your life now, especially when you're running performance. So, you know, and I keep telling and keep thinking that you have to be, they're actually one step ahead of you always. So, you know, by the time you've figured out a way of fraud, you realize there's, oh, there's this also, and there's something else also, because they continuously keep evolving. So it's more like a, you know, a Tom and Jerry chase of trying to figure out who's smarter than the other, and how do you, you know, try to filter out fraudsters, because frankly, it's about money, and people are thinking, you know, day and night to figure out how to spam or, you know, cheat, or how to generally make money. And fraud happens, I think, in various ways and kinds. And, you know, some that are pure to the that are purely visible to the eye, and some that you won't even realize are happening, you know. And then over a period of time, you because by the time you're able to detect, you know, you've already realized that 10 days have already gone by the campaigns. So we use you know, Apps Flyer as our attribution tool, and we've definitely enabled the Protect 360. That's the hygiene thing that you would, you know, that you would land up doing to ensure that the fraud is at least controlled at a high level. What we also do is a lot of our affiliate payouts are generally based out of the CRM numbers, and they're not based out of any other, you know, tool, third party tool as well. So that's one way that we try to ensure that, you know, we are ensuring that we don't. The other thing that we do is we try to put certain metrics between, you know, say registration to a business goal. If that's not met by certain affiliates or by certain campaigns, then that's the campaign that we try and dig deep. If, you know, they're underperforming by what the regular organic or biddable media would show ratios like. In terms of examples, like we have, I mean, there are multiple examples. You know, when we started affiliates, we used to see app decompilation happening. We used to see events getting triggered on, say, a platform, and not having any numbers in the CRM. Or we used to see cases where, you know, the organic suddenly would go down, like organic numbers would suddenly start like steep, you know, stoop down to like less than 20% or so, which used to be like 50% odd. So you realize that there is something happening, you know, and that's probably either click fraud, click injection, app decompilation. I mean, there are multiple ways, device ID. So I think what's more important, so these are like examples, and, you know, recently we did one campaign and we realized that people are, you know, they create scripts of your app, and they, you know, circulate the scripts in the market for people to take advantage. So it depends on it, you know, you have to understand how are you paying your affiliates, or how are you paying your users for, you know, and how do you then see and then figure out how do you ensure that there is no, I mean, how do you protect yourself from these fraud things? Yeah, so I think those are like a couple of examples, business examples.
Understood. No, thank you so much, Ankit. I think as performance marketers, one thing which we deal with, I think, which brand marketers don't deal with, is that if you're getting too good a performance, then you're most likely getting fraud traffic. If you're getting too bad a performance, obviously it's bad, but too good is also bad.
You can't get happy when.
That's a mystery which I think brand marketers never have experienced. And I think you see the data and you say, hey, this channel is outstanding. And you suddenly get a hit that, okay, all of it was bad, right? Parush, we heard a lot from Ankit on app. What is your thought on web? What do you use for web tracking? And how do you protect yourself on fraud on web?
Sure. So I think right now we're using GA for our web tracking. Like app, there are a lot of options on the app side to kind of protect ourselves from fraud detection. Even after you detect, how do you kind of take care of everything on that? On the website, there are lesser options is what we found. It is also, I think, because the ecosystem, at least on the media side, is moving more towards the app, right? More and more consumption is happening on the app side. More and more usage is happening on that side. So web is kind of the forgotten, lost bag and in the background right now. On the website, the kind of campaigns we run on the website are more to do with user acquisition and, let's say, wanting users to stream a particular content that we have with us, right? So over there, we find even more problems, and the kind of markets we do web marketing in, like I mentioned, Pakistan, Bangladesh, which is kind of similar to where India is right now, a lot more challenges, a lot more fraud happening over there. And fraud happens at all multiple levels, right? I mean, in the end, it is, you have to understand, you're paying a particular partner for giving you something. So it could be paying a particular partner to giving you a click, to giving you an install, to giving you a user to come on board, remarketing, new user, anything, right? So the incentive for the users, for the partner or the sub partner is always there to kind of send some traffic for which he would not have to kind of pay for and pocket the profits as such, right? So on the website, we found a lot of happening to us, especially in countries where we do this in Southeast Asia, in the SAARC region, in Bangladesh as well. I think, that's what it is.
Understood. By the way, you know, one of the issues, of course, in web is that, as you rightly said, a lot of advertisers are on GA like yourself. And some of the tools which have become very popular in app are not present, right, in web. Yep. By the way, GA just, you know, suffers actually from some really bad weaknesses. It's very easily spoofable. A lot of advertisers are not aware that, you know, GA actually doesn't protect against fraud. It only flags off only those cases which are known bots. So bots which are good bots, like the Google search bot or the or so on, which are declaring themselves as bots, GA will remove those. But apart from that, GA doesn't do about it. And that typically, you know, surprises a lot of advertisers. In fact, one thing which I can recommend all advertisers tuned into this is that, you know, the default attribution window on GA is normally 6 months, which means that if an inorganic source drove a visit today, for the next 6 months, when that user comes organically, GA will still track it against the original source. So that's the default setting. And unless you've gone and changed it consciously, you might just be overlapping your organic traffic very, very heavily on GA. That's something which a lot of advertisers miss out on. Okay, Gaurav, over to you. I want to, check with you on more on lead campaigns. I'm sure as fintech, you know, lead CPL campaigns are a mainstay. What's your thought on fraud on lead campaigns? How are you dealing with that? And I'm sure a lot of this would have, you know, also will boil down into your call center and customer care services, where, you know, fraud ends up hitting and impacting your call center agents in terms of, you know, bad leads. What's your thought on that?
So you rightly said, I think the performance campaign on a lead campaign, as one of the speaker also mentioned, it also depends on the commercial you have, right? Wherever the marketer will put in his money, the fraud will start happening in that way. For example, if you say, okay, I will pay you per lead, then you will get a lot of junk lead or something like that. Then you maybe move to a next level. You may say, okay, on disposition, which will come from sales team. Then you put OTP. Then something new kind of things happen, right? Then you say, okay, I will only pay for account opening. Then some new kind of frauds happen. So I think it's just a, you don't know. So fraud is happening, but you don't know which one is the fraud one, right? And probably ultimately you spend some money. Maybe after 2-3 months, you say, okay, I'm not recovering my money. Maybe this is not working and so on and so forth. or maybe you can have various check and balances in between. Sometimes you can have a tool in between, or maybe you look at IP. But I think it's fraudsters are running ahead than marketers. I would say wherever you put in money, they come with some solution for the revenue leakage. So that's how this entire thing works, right? So if you say CPL, then something will happen. CPL, if you say impression, so impression to any which way is like a bot and all that stuff. Even if you went till the account opening level where you need PAN, Aadhaar, everything you need, right? There also you will see they are so smart that probably they come up with something or the other that... So they are great educators. I look at these people, right? I think they educate you a lot. I think they make your... you think that, okay, now nobody... There would be no revenue leakage or maybe no marketing leakage. And you'll say, okay, this is the most tightest contract I can have. And suddenly you will see some affiliate, some partner outsmarting you. So I think that's the reality of life and we all have to accept it. But yes, that's...
No, I came out with a very interesting, we were working, this credit card company was actually running a campaign on one of the largest e-commerce portals. And point was that you register for a credit card, you put your interest for a credit card and you get a gift voucher from on that e-commerce portal, right? Now, normally it would not go wrong. You are running on one of the largest e-commerce portals in the country. People will have to fill up their details for applying. And they were actually further doing a CIBIL check and an Aadhaar check to further validate, right? They actually got credit card leads from Amitabh Bachchan, Abhishek Bachchan, and Jay Bhadri, right? And all for a 500 rupee gift voucher. And the crazy part was that they were all CIBIL validated. Because what was there was that the PAN numbers and date of birth information for a lot of these famous people is publicly available. So someone just went and filled up these forms. And when they tried to validate that PAN number on CIBIL, it existed, the date of birth matched, the name matched, right? Abhishek Bachchan exists as a person. But of course, he was not filling up the credit card lead, right? So very, very innovative people out there. And I think always a learning opportunity for everyone to, you know, understand. Mr. Prabhakar, Gaurav just mentioned that, you know, for example, on impressions, right? And obviously, if someone can fake a account opening, then impressions is like easy money, right? Right. I know you mentioned that you're running on programmatic, which is effectively a CPM-based campaign. What are your thoughts on fraud protection on programmatic campaign? And how are you protecting yourself against it currently?
See, first of all, we do not go for empty impression. It doesn't help. And we have certain benchmark in terms of our impression to click ratio, which are already well established because we have been spending a lot on Google platform for a very long time. So we have an idea for our search campaign, display campaign, video campaign, discovery campaigns, you know, what are the click impression ratio we have and all of that. So when we work with any publisher, we sure that, you know, our kind of contracts are very watertight. And also in case if it kind of goes kind of in a different direction altogether, either too good or too bad, that's when we have a discussion. So far what we have seen that we have been able to kind of, you know, some payment we have kind of not made. We told them this is not possible. This is an issue. Either you know about it, don't know about it, but solve for it. Here is our data. And that's how we have managed so far. So we have been able to do all of that because we have a lot of history running non-programmatic and a lot of data points which are available at the touch of a button, and we are able to compare performance. So that has been our advantage.
No, but Mr. Tiwari, just spending two more minutes on that. How do you know that the data which you have itself right now is not polluted? I mean, one of the issues is a baseline issue, right? I mean, what you're basically comparing is that a new performance should be very similar to an older performance. How do you know that the older performance was not fraud, for example?
No, you're right. I mean, I wouldn't say that, you know, we have a foolproof model there, but it's a matter of being a range bound, you know, that range is expected. And also, you know, we are working with partners, you know, who have done it like far longer and for variety of categories than, you know, ours, right? So we also take their kind of views on this. Having said that, I believe a lot more needs to be done. We also use Protect 360 from Apps Flyer, but mostly we don't do much affiliate campaign on mobile. So it doesn't work for us so much. And also over time, we have cut down on our affiliate campaign because we have seen our app campaign giving us better conversion and more cost efficiently. So we have cut down on affiliate campaigns. So that way, like, you know, I would believe that our exposure seems to be on a lower side, but of course, I'm sure there's if there are solutions, we can definitely try it out.
No, absolutely. I mean, the sense I'm getting from the audience is that all of you have some tools and protections in place, but you keep getting surprised with new issues and new problems, right? I think it's a recurring theme that you put in some checks and fraudsters outsmart those checks and they come in with, you know, you have to keep evolving and keep adding in new things. And maybe the technology needs to keep in, I mean, ideally, if the technology was there, then everything should have been perfect, right? You should not have seen anything also, right? Because all of it would have been hidden off and cleaned off. But unfortunately, that the sense I'm getting is that that's not the case. Arvind, maybe let me take you to a slightly more difficult question. A lot of the panelists have been running on Biddable, and Google and Facebook are one of the biggest duopoly in the market. And I'm sure you also run a lot of campaigns on Google and Facebook. I just want to broad base this. Do you think ad fraud is an affiliate only issue? Do you think ad fraud is also there on Google, Facebook? And I mean, there have been a lot of media articles on how Google has been identified with a lot of bots running in. YouTube was recently, a year ago, it was found that YouTube was actually billing on bot traffic. Have you faced something like that on your campaigns? And what are you doing to prevent yourself against that? Because I'm sure I'm sure as a wallet share, they actually have a very high wallet share, right? So in terms of, even though the absolute percentages might be lower, the exposure when you multiply with the wallet share might actually be much higher, right? Because your bulk of your wallet will be going there. So what's your comment on that?
Dhiraj, taking the broadest view of ad fraud, so to say, some of the common challenges we face are viewability, brand safety. Apart from the ad frauds that our performance campaigns kind of face. So the viewability itself, I would say, is a very, very challenging task, so to say, across all our platforms. Though we have used third-party platforms, I think that's the best solution, best and sustainable solution, I would say, for getting a single view and a comprehensive view of viewability. Otherwise, viewability across platforms are inconsistent and it doesn't give you a high level view. And the second, I would say, is brand safety. So in that sense, there are ad fraud concerns across networks. It is not restricted to affiliates. For example, for brand safety, being a global brand, some of the family marketing, as we call it, campaigns, we have to be extra careful that, there are some categories that are excluded, for example, using DV360D. So that we are on the right side of brand safety. And even today, there is a big discussion going on with Facebook globally. As you have heard, there are many brands that have kind of raised the issue with Facebook. And we are one of those brands which have kind of raised this issue, trying to solve it from a global perspective before we resume advertising. And then, of course, coming to app install campaigns. So click hijacking and the likes are very common. And admittedly, there have been times in the past where affiliates form a significant chunk of our investment. One of the panelists alluded to it earlier, and we have seen organic crashing many a time, and then we have to kind of intervene. Though we use tools like AppsFlyer, so I would say that the issue of ad fraud is broad based across platforms. The challenges in each of the platform does vary, and we have to kind of tackle it on a platform to platform or a objective to objective basis. So for example, like the panelists mentioned, right? Some of the affiliates, everything is cost per order for us, right? In the end, it's all about maximizing the ROI on our orders, food delivery orders. So we do have that lens when we kind of do payout. We do have those controls, but the challenge is quite immense.
So absolutely. I mean, it's always interesting to hear how, organic, for example, is something which keeps dropping for a lot of people. And you tweak your campaign and suddenly organic increases or decreases. It's almost like magic, right? And for a lot of CMOs who come from traditional media, for whom, you know, organic is more based on your brand loyalty and you know, brand penetration and word of mouth, seeing organic go up and down so heavily like a swing seems to be like, what the hell is happening, right? I think it's a challenging proposition. And just spending 2 minutes on brand safety, right? And I see very few performance marketeers talking about brand safety. And you know, you are one of those which raised on this. So maybe I should not ask you, but maybe I should ask Porush, right? Porush, why do performance marketeers don't consider brand safety in their mix? Generally, we see this as a burden on brand marketeers. And not on performance marketers. In fact, we see a lot of performance marketers who don't even care about things like Arvind mentioned, right? Viewability or, you know, categories which are valid, invalid, and so on. What's your sense on it?
I think that's to do with the construct of the company and the construct of the team, I feel. Right now, at Z5 at least, all of the creatives or all of the campaigns that go out are a responsibility of my team. So I think a lot of brand safety issues, a lot of those concerns, though they are kind of championed by another person or another team or another leader, they come and they kind of go to the market through us. So in a way, I think now a lot of things are changing regarding that. I think a lot of performance marketeers as well are held accountable for how and what they're doing. And not only from an ROI point of view, which we always had to kind of deal with, but also from a viewability point of view, right? And in cases of brands which want to kind of make a name in the industry, make a name just generally also, I think like McDonald's, like someone in the entertainment space as well, it's very important that brand safety is kind of looked at and kind of addressed by the performance campaigns and the teams as well. So I think that's a more of a thought process that is kind of been changing right now, but I think definitely it's kind of coming down in the performance marketers kitty now that you have to kind of look at that as well.
So thank you so much for your thoughts on that, Porush. By the way, Arvind, since you mentioned on brand safety and category blacklisting, I do want to flag off that, you know, one of the issues which many of these blacklisting mechanisms face in terms of keyword and category is Indian regional languages. India has so many regional languages, and while, you know, a lot of tools work out well for English and maybe a little bit for Hindi, when you go down the funnel, then, for example, SMEs, I don't know if you're aware, but Google, for example, doesn't support even targeting on a regional language like SMEs, right? So if you want to run a campaign on the SMEs language and say, you know, I want to only target those videos which are on that language, you currently can't. And if you can't target, then obviously the brand safety, a part of it is, you know, way down the line. So I just wanted to flag up for all advertisers that this whole category keyword issue, you know, while globally for the Western world definitely works because of English being the dominant language. In India, YouTube, about 70 to 80% of content consumed is local languages. And that I think is an India specific issue, which I think the English based brand safety tools may not be supporting very well. Yeah. Ankit, when you're running ad campaigns, and you told me initially that you're running a lot of retargeting campaigns, how do you solve for fraud on retargeting campaigns, and what are you measuring? I mean, retargeting campaigns fundamentally face the same issue like an acquisition campaign, click hijacking, organic stealing, capturing your loyal organic users and just showing them as re-engaged so that you have good ROAS. How are you protecting your re-engagement campaigns in the app world?
Yeah, I think that's a big question, you know, and not only in India, but I think it's a globally, there's a big question on how do you really, really attribute or measure the success of your re-attribution campaign? Because, so I think the only way we have currently, I mean, there is no genuine way to, you know, genuinely attribute that cost that we have, but what we tend to do is we tend to do split tests between campaigns which are run with retargeting and one which are not run with retargeting. And then we also, the retargeting campaigns, we try and just evaluate in terms of what platforms are bringing us. But as of now, except figuring out, you know, whether the, you know, whether the person has come beyond the window of that 7 days that we have currently, and has it, you know, come in with this retargeting campaign, because the costs from retargeting seems to be seemingly low than what it is otherwise. So we're still figuring a way out to, you know, genuinely measure how effectively to see if there is fraud in retargeting.
Yeah. No, absolutely. Because, you know, like we started, if your cost is way too low and your ROS is fantastic, then most likely there's a problem there, right? So I think identifying the problem is the first step, and then, you know, you can probably look for a solution on that. Yeah. But my our understanding in terms of our analysis shows that retargeting is a wild, wild west right now, simply because a lot of campaigns run on CPC model. While, you know, acquisition campaigns have gone right down to, as Gaurav mentioned, right up to order and account opening, retargeting campaigns are still mostly paid on CPC with maybe an aspect of ROAS built in as a metric or something, right? Which means that for a lot of advertisers, getting bad clicks is something which, when mixed up with all the other clicks, might actually just completely screw up and might impact their investments. So, Gaurav, one question on a different aspect. One of the aspects of, you know, performance marketing is incentivized campaigns. And where, you know, we see a lot of incentivized properties where college students come in, you know, they get offers like, you know, do this thing, keep your app, install the app, keep it for 7 days, register, and, you know, you will get, say, 10 rupees, right? And you are effectively, I mean, your spends are effectively creating those incentive models, right? How do you solve against those? Because obviously those will be really bad in quality, and what are you doing to protect yourself against those things like those?
Okay. So if you really ask me, yes, you rightly said. So for example, as I said, if I put 100 rupees for some partner, that I will pay you 100 rupees for this. What he will do is he will go to some platform like this and say, I will give 5 rupees Paytm cashback, and suddenly you will see, oh, suddenly the campaign is performing so well. So first thing is, campaign is performing very well. There is some problem. Right? So you have to definitely look into it. And it is more reactive approach, if I tell you. There is no proactive approach to it. But there is a reactive approach to it. Then suddenly it will go through the sales team. Sales team will talk to them. Understand, you get a lot of feedback, right? Suddenly if it is a lot of, let's say, leads coming in from one source, definitely you tend to get a lot of feedback from your sales team and people. But to be very honest, these are very, very, very reactive approaches. As I said, wherever you put in your money, the fraudster or somebody who wants to do some fraud is ready with some new idea, or there are some, I think these apps and these models are probably fueled by a marketer like us. Maybe let's say 5% of everybody who is spending in India goes to these apps, and probably everybody is happy. The student is happy, the app is happy, and marketer is losing out money. But it is a reactive approach, to be very, very honest with you on that.
I think, Dheeraj, just to add, you need to keep your eye on YouTube and on Telegram these days. So, you know, what I've personally done these days is whenever we have a referral campaign or something on, I first day go in the morning and just put up on YouTube, download Dhani app. And then, you know, you generally see these kind of people and you go, oh, they've done this also. So, I mean, that's
we actually had a public case study here. So maybe I can quote that for Big Basket. They actually had a referral program. And they face this problem called on Google brand bidding, where what happens is that people were bidding on Big Basket keywords on the Google search. Obviously, Big Basket keyword on Google search will have the least CAC, right? Most people will be searching out of convenience, clicking on it and going and converting very well. So there were two issues we identified. One was affiliates doing that, especially on a cost per sale or a, as Gaurav said, a cost per account open kind of in a campaign, you'll actually get a lot of your organic, which was coming on Google search, you know, get redirected. By the way, the side issue of this is that your Google bid rates will go up. So you'll actually pay more to Google as well, right? You'll pay more for affiliates for conversion, but you'll also pay for Google as well. And the second interesting thing, Ankit, which you mentioned rightly, was that there were people who were referrals, end customers, who were actually taking the referral code and running a Google Ads campaign of promoting the referral code, right? And they were recommending people to use that referral code on checkout on BigBasket so that they also get benefited out of that. So very, very interesting on how Google search and brand keywords on Google search can be misused by your end customers and your partners And more so in terms of increasing our bid rates on Google, which actually can be a pretty heavy effect. Mr. Prabhakar, coming back to you. So as a CMO, and you know, I want to, because you are the CMO on this panel, so I want to raise this question to you. I'm sure the brand teams and performance teams both are reporting to you, right? Now, we just discussed how organic can very quickly shuffle around, right? So your brand team obviously would have its targets on organic, word of mouth, reach, and making sure organic is there, while your performance team might actually gain by stealing organic. I mean, if I take a very, very negative view, a performance team might be happy getting organic stolen because that will jack up the performance team's ROI. As a CMO, which has both brand and performance teams reporting to you, how do you solve for this dilemma? How do you, because obviously these are competing benchmarks, brand team and performance teams are competing. How do you split this up? Because ad fraud can result in, you know, both the teams to fight over each other.
You know, I think that sometimes is regarding the culture of the place, you know, and how do you kind of make your team come together, you know. So maybe earlier the brand team and performance marketing team used to work in silos. But since I took over, my view was that, you know, all of you are part of the same team. And what I realized as I started having the content people, brand people sit in the SEO meetings and the performance marketing people sit in the social media meetings, which are under brand.
Wow.
A lot of this camaraderie, this collaboration started happening. So today we track, I'll tell you, I mean, this is very interesting. Couple of days back, my brand team now reports that how much of organic traffic and also with the help of Google Campaign Manager, we're able to look at the assisted lead. So we just don't do last click conversion, but we also give credit for assisted lead. So the social media team will track like what is the assisted lead, how the trend has been increasing month by month, and also traffic. So last time we saw the data that social media team reporting was way too high. Then what was the case? And they were like, no, we took the data from GA only. How is that possible? Then we went deeper into this and we realized that the SEO team is only taking traffic data for the main domain because they do not want to dilute their own parameters. And also some of the newer campaigns which I started on social media, some of those impressions and those traffic are also being measured by the brand team.
VTA was enabled.
That was the case. So net, the point I want to make is that eventually as a marketing guys, we have to balance it out because somewhere the efforts which brand team make in YouTube or OTT campaign has a positive reward, and also what performance marketing team do, because what we have seen, any paid spend increase in UAC campaign, universal app campaign in mobile app, we have seen the organic app install also increasing. So there is a linear correlation. So somewhere, and also I'll tell you one more thing. So currently we are in top five in our category, and we know that our history has made us very strong in paid. Organic, we can do better and we are creating new assets. And we know our competition is far, far stronger in organic. So nowadays with the help of SimilarWeb and all, we actually track our traffic as a percentage of their traffic. And we ensure that we are gaining in that also. Because then, so then we have a relative sense in terms of how we are performing vis-a-vis the market. So that's how we manage it.
No, thank you so much, Mr. Tiwari. That was very interesting. Arvind, do you think CMOs, especially CMOs which come from traditional media, understand things like VTAs, CTAs, attribution windows, inactivity timers? And do you think, performance marketeers, sorry for all this, but do you think performance marketers are taking advantage of the CMO in this case?
Well, can't rule that out. I think it's a very steep learning curve for traditional marketeers. But kudos to many of them who are making that transition, who are, absorbing these trends very fast, are digitally savvy themselves. But frankly, in a larger scope of things, I would say this is a very small percentage of traditional CMOs who are successfully able to make the cut. In brand meetings, talk the language of brand, and in performance marketing meetings, switching that language, right? And having enough depth of knowledge to kind of get the best out of both. So on the second part of your question, you know, performance marketeers who have, let's say, traditional CMOs, there is a misfit, right? That's a misfit, and it's a loss for the organization. And I really liked what Prabhakar was talking about, how to treat all of this as a whole, and that's what we also do. Look at digital seamlessly. Rather than, even though there is a brand function and a performance marketing function, I and we kind of bring it together. It's an ongoing process, Dheeraj. Generally speaking, I can see a lot more traditional marketeers making those transition, which is very good. But I think there is a huge case, like I keep telling young students professionals early in their career, that there's a huge demand for digital professionals who can talk both brand and performance seamlessly.
No, absolutely. Just constructing it for the audience, performance marketing, you can actually change some of the measurement criteria, and by simply changing some parameters, you can actually show fantastic performance. And by just setting them too high or too low, you might actually cannibalize on your own brand campaigns or your organic campaigns. And a lot of CMOs need to be aware that how a performance marketing can very heavily work on both ways, depending on how you are setting your setup up, right? A very simple example is, should you bid on your brand keywords or not, right? A performance marketer will say, absolutely, a brand keyword, why not? You know, we should bid on it. While one way to look at it is that you might actually be cannibalizing on your own organic, because people who are searching for, say, McDonald's are most likely already going to convert, right? So you're effectively spending money to jack up your performance on your search campaign, and I'm sure there are different reasons for it. I'm not putting that this is the only answer, but I'm just saying that some as simple decision like this can, you know, change the metrics of brand and performance teams. Arvind, just continuing one more topic which I touched about on Google search, we talked about how brand bidding can happen, where partners, affiliates, can bid on brand keywords. How are you solving for that? Because that can have the impact on your bid rates on Google, to shoot up, and that can probably end up, you know, screwing up your ROI or your optimization of your search engine campaign.
Yeah. So in fact, our problem is wider, right? So there are many, for example, food delivery apps, which also, bid on our keywords. It's a real problem. We had tried dealing with it in a few simplistic ways. We didn't get very far. And now the problem is quite acute, because the demand has shrunk, and everyone is kind of going after this shrunken market, don't have numbers to quote, but we know that ad fraud is way higher than what it was pre-COVID. But the good news, Dheeraj, is that solutions to all of these problems exist, right? Through analytics and through tools, and there is emerging space of both. I think one needs to ask these questions and try out those solutions. So we are working very closely with some of our partners. We aim to try out a few of those tools that kind of make sure that we're spending the money, right money in the right place. So otherwise, we don't know where our money is going, and we are happy with our overall cost per order, within the zone. But when you double click on it, you realize that, there's a lot going on behind it. So I think, we are, traveling that journey and making sure that we are working with a lot of tools, albeit on an experimental basis, before we kind of zoom on and what we want to do as a way of working.
Absolutely. Porush, any finishing points on your side? We are roughly out of time, but I just want to take your sense on what Arvind said about asking questions, and what's your thought on ad fraud in general for Z5?
So ad fraud, like I think so everyone mentioned over here, right? It is something that people are having to deal with and have dealt with for the longest time. the fraudsters are becoming smarter, just as the marketers are getting as much information about everyone. It's just that to be one step ahead of the fraudsters, we have to keep on evolving, just as our campaigns are evolving on a quarter on quarter, year on year basis. We have to not be too happy if things are going very good for us, and always keep an eye on the bigger picture, right? I mean, your overall funnel needs to keep improving. If only your performance marketing campaigns are doing very good, or if you're getting your ROI very low, but your actual revenue is not increasing, your actual ROI is not improving, I think that's what you need to keep an eye on. And yeah, that's how we kind of manage this over a period of time.
No, I think this is a good point to, you know, kind of just summarize. I think asking questions, I think that's what I take away, Arvind. Thank you so much for that. I think if you ask questions, you actually then start pointing towards finding solutions. And the sense I get is that there are a lot of questions, you know, which were there, which are issues, which the panelists are dealing with in different ways, some with tech, some with manual, some with, you know, looking at end metrics only or payout models. I think a lot of this is now available as tech. Advertisers have the capability of getting solutions and not depend on manual exercises or their own efforts. They can actually focus more on the actual campaign rather than focusing on things like those. But I think it all starts with asking questions. So I think I want to, you know, kind of summarize on that. Rohil, we are...
Yes, Dheeraj, thank you so much. Yes,
questions.
Wonderful discussion, very insightful points raised. And we have a whole lot of questions. I have just put together some of them in the interest of time. So this is open to all of you. Anyone can answer it. So the first question is from Tushar Devan. The question is, I am using GA to measure my web campaigns, and GA has protection against bots, and I pay only on actual sale. Can I assume I am safe from ad fraud?
I think I covered that one partially though, and Porush, maybe you can comment on it because you're using GA for your web. But very briefly, absolutely not. GA doesn't protect you from bots. What GA gives you as an option is only to remove known bots, the good bots, from your calculations. And the onus of fraud actually lies on you. Porush, maybe you could spend 2 minutes on that.
No, exactly. Yeah, so that's exactly what it is. You can give an example of how we detect fraud on the website, right? So let's say we are running campaigns for a person, and we will pay an affiliate only when the person views 5 video views on our platform. A person who wants to do fraud, they can actually just come and integrate their click just before the person comes on board and says that this organic person is actually coming from affiliate 1 or affiliate 2 or affiliate 3, right? And after that, whatever the person does on your platform, it's all attributed down the funnel to this particular affiliate 1, 2, or 3. So no, you have to be very vigilant. You have to either use a partner or tool to kind of help you understand how to kind of deal with bots, or you need to have a very strong data science team and keep asking questions within team on how your actual performance is happening and what you're seeing. Are you seeing any incrementality by doing affiliate 1, 2, or 3? Or if and when you stop campaigns from affiliate 1, are you even seeing a drop in users or drop in video views or not in our case? So yeah, to answer your question, you can't assume that you're safe, and you have to keep checking on that for sure.
Right.
In fact, just one food for thought for 2 minutes on that. I don't know if you know, you're aware, if you inspect the page, if you go to Chrome and you inspect the page, you can actually read the GA pixel on any website. Copy that, put it on any random website and open that website 1,000 times. In all those 1,000 visits, will get tracked on the actual GA analysis of the advertiser. Which means that GA is very, very easy to spoof, and you can actually trigger GA 1,000 times, million times without opening the web page itself, right? So remember that, and definitely keep asking questions. Okay.
Right.
Yeah.
Rohit. There's another question for specific to Arvind, which is, I would like to ask that McDonald's had gone through a crisis. After that, the company removed many items from the menu. Was it difficult to reach the was it difficult to remarket the brand and products? How did you deal with ad fraud on email lists?
Two questions, right? McDonald's, at least to my knowledge, McDonald's doesn't have a big problem with the fake email lists in that sense. So maybe some other panelist can take that. So yes, on the first part, as you know, the last 4-5 months has been both the supply crisis and the demand crisis. So we have to kind of approach the whole situation with a focused menu, as we call it. So that, and then slowly over time, we kind of reintroduced all the favorites back onto the menu. We did receive complaints from customers, but we do have a reasonably good CRM tool so that we could let customers know whoever has complained about this product not being available. Let's say a month later it's made available, we do reach out to those customers and let them know about it. So it is something that we have been dealing with, but largely we are out of that situation, which was there about 90 days. So on the second question of fake email list, maybe some other panelists can take it. Dheeraj, you want to?
Gaurav, I think lead campaigns would have a lot of email list issues. What's your thoughts on that?
See, so lead campaigns have, so for example, again, I said, if you're working with affiliate, probably you don't pay for email. So you need not to be worried. You need to be worried about what you're paying for. So first golden rule is you need to be worried about what that contract is all about, on what you are paying the money. If whatever you are paying the money for, the fraud will happen on that front, right? Or for example, there's a lot of database organization has, I'm just talking about generally. And if you feel there is a lot of fake emails, the emails people don't open, they're not fake emails. Gaurav has 10 emails, but he is active on one email and probably doesn't open other 10. So there are a lot of email service provider. If you're using a good service provider who has a good network, he can, if you scrub your data against that data he has, you will get a
valid email IDs.
Good idea, valid email IDs, what are there. But that is again not 100% proof, but you will get some sense out of it. And then probably you can also map it to the from the source which is coming and so on. So that's right. How the, I think, email thing could be tackled.
I just want to take some more questions. A lot of questions. One is, again, for everyone, it is from Parimal K. How much duration is good to find about the fraud in a campaign? What is the duration that you can figure out the fraud is there?
So my sense is that I think it depends on the campaign and the size of the campaign. Obviously, if the size is very, very small, you would not have enough data to, you know, identify anything out of it. If the size is large, then even a few hours is good enough for you to get a sense of making the baseline and then start identifying what is good and bad and maybe training your models or identifying outliers, etc. I think it's more a function of volume rather than time in terms of finding what is the right benchmark for you to look at. That's my thought on it. But anyone else wants to take that up?
So Dheeraj, if I can add to it, in my view, I think it is also dependent on the product you are selling, the product life cycle. So how long is your sales cycle? If your sales cycle is, let's say, average of 30 days, so then 30 days only you will come to know that whether the fraud is happening or not. Or it is like immediately you want a download or maybe an app install. Then it may be for a few days. Or if it is a B2B, because we also do a lot of B2B campaigns, there the cycle is far more higher, maybe 6 months. After 6 months, you may realize that, okay, this source or this partner has done the fraud, no lead has converted, and probably we were doing so much of a follow-up and so on and so forth. So it is also dependent on the product and the
platform,
the sales cycle and the brand also.
Right. Another question from Upasana Upadhyay. My partners bid on my brand keywords and ended up increasing my bid rates on search. What can I do about it?
Anyone wants to take that? I've talked about it, so I don't want to answer that. Porush, have you faced this issue? Do you want to talk about it?
I think my partners, Upasana, I think she means competitors.
Right.
Yeah, I think it could also be affiliates or anyone, I think, not necessarily competition only.
Like for McDonald's, it could be like, you know, food, this delivery company.
Totally. Yeah.
So, Arvind, if you want to take it specifically for McDonald's, but yeah, I think what we can do when our partners or our competitors are bidding on our brand keywords is from an organic side, be very strong in terms of whatever content you have or how you build your brand presence, have enough material to kind of support your own brand on that. I think that is one thing that from a branding point of view, it is very important to have a good presence over there. Also, just be in the race for as long as you can, right? I mean, if you are paying, let's say, 5 rupees for a click on your brand or 1 rupee for a click on your brand, this other partner or competitor as such would have to do at least 2, 3, 4, 5 times, right? So if not enough people will have enough money to burn to kind of keep on doing that to you. So just stay in the game for long enough and you can see them wither away, yeah.
Right.
By the way,
just
to follow up on that, Porush, have you seen cases where your competition ran up your search budget? We keep hearing, you know, scare stories where, you know, people say that my competition came, ran out all my budget in the first hour of the day and, you know, on Google search and there was no protection which came from the platform. So have you faced something like that and what are you doing about it?
Yeah, so we had. So interestingly, about half a year back, we were launching our campaign in UAE, in Middle East. At the same time, one of our competitors were also launching in the same region. An Indian competitor was launching over there, and they had much more deeper pockets than us. So yes, ZTV as such is very well known across the globe, especially in the India, wherever we have a lot of Indians, right? So we did face that issue, but like I said, it was an issue which was kind of hampering my performance, kind of hampering the KPIs that we were looking at, the cost per users, the cost per subscriptions that we were seeing in that particular period for a month, for a quarter, was looking bad. But what we tried and told management is just the same thing that I'm saying right now, right? The learning is that you have to stay in the game. If you are facing the brunt of this, your competitor is definitely facing a much, much steeper challenge, and hence they are trying to do this to you. Your competitor is only paying about 2, 3, 4 times, like I said, to get a user who's actually saying, I want to come to Z5, and then also may or may not get the user from there, right? So if you can, and if budgets, and if you can kind of ask management and budgets can be made available, you should kind of stick the guns on that one, yeah.
And Dheeraj, especially if you have VC-funded competition who don't have the pressure of quarter-to-quarter P&Ls, it's a real, real challenge.
No, yeah, so, but I think the platform allows that, right? The platform does. Exactly. The platform allows that. In fact, if you go to the platform, they'll tell you to run an ad on YouTube, which directs people back to Google search, and then bid on your brand keywords there. So that's the challenge of the platform, I think. And
Actually, I wanted to just direct attention. I mean, Porush, I think what you mentioned was more on competitive, basically competition also bidding on your keywords and you and your competition both fighting each other. But I think another issue which we see is competition actually consciously is running bots and clicking on your ads so that your click budget gets exhausted. So your campaigns then, you know, your daily cap gets exhausted. So your campaign disappears and then their campaign can run for the rest of the day, right? In fact, so we've actually rolled out a lot of solutions on Google and Facebook fraud analysis where we can go and blacklist in real time IPs, placements, which are generating bot traffic so that your budgets don't get, eaten up by your competition, because competition can just come and keep clicking on your ads 1,000 times and your daily budget is gone. And then their ad can run at a much lower cost with no competition for the rest of the day. So,
I have one final question. Yes, one final question is, name is not given, that thank you for this wonderful discussion on retargeting fraud. If we target very specific audiences, would the scope for ad fraud be lower?
Ankit, you had talked about retargeting. You want to take this up?
The chances are definitely lower if you have your own databases and if you're running your own campaigns. So we have definitely seen that campaigns that we run in-house, which means a lot of data, specifically database campaigns, we see definitely better conversion rates and better ROI on those, because obviously it is more managed as a campaign. But you know, if your data is only incorrect, or if your database quality has been generated by a campaign which had so much of fraud already, so then obviously you will not be able to hamper, but definitely you will be able to derive more value in terms of more learnings in terms of what you should be doing as step two.
Great. Thank you so much. We are out of time, and it's been a great discussion. I'm sure it merits more such discussions, because it is a huge task to control in ad fraud, which is growing by the day. But thank you for this wonderful conversation. And any last words from you, Dheeraj?
No, I think thank you so much. I think I just end with that same pattern. Asking questions is the start. When you identify the problem, you've solved half the puzzle. And that will actually allow you to find tools, technologies, solutions, processes, both internally and externally, to solve this problem. I think the only way to solve ad fraud is to cut down the revenue in terms of the money flowing to the fraudsters. If the money flowing to fraudsters gets cut down, that's when the incentive to do fraud gets off and you can actually safeguard your campaigns. So I think that's the focus for everyone, how to cut down the money flow to fraudsters.
Thank you, gentlemen, once again, and hopefully see you soon. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Thank you. Thank you. Take care, everyone. Stay safe.